Good afternoon, everyone who's joining us online here from Impressions Gallery and our 7th annual photo book fair. This year's theme is on home, and it's been inspired by our current exhibition that you can see round about us, In Which Language Do You Dream?, which is a collaboration between socially engaged photographer Rich Wiles and Ruba Al-Hadawi, the mother of a Syrian family who have now been resettled here in England. On that theme, the next talk we're going to be is this book here, The Moon Belongs to Everyone, published by GOST Books. And it's by Stacy Mehrfar, who we've got coming all the way from live from upstate New York. I just love that background, Stacy. Amazing, but envious. And Stuart, your background's nice and green too. Stuart Smith, who's the editor and designer at GOST. So The Moon Belongs to Everyone is a response to the contemporary experience of migration. It's a multi-layered visual narrative set in an unidentified landscape. It reflects upon the loss of roots and search for belonging in the wake of migration. So I'll hand over to Stacy and Stuart, who's going to talk for half an hour. Then we're going to stop. Some people from the gallery will be invited to ask questions if you've got any questions. And also, please, if you're watching online, type in your questions and Stuart will sort of field them at the end as well. So really looking forward to this discussion. Stacy and Stuart, The Moon Belongs to Everyone.
Well, it's now us then, Stace.
Thank you, Anne.
Thank you, Anne. Well, what I'll start by saying, how did I meet Stacy? What happens is people often send in submissions or apply to GOST, to the info, and I have Katie would look at these types of submissions and then decide whether to put them forward. I will say that we may, out of every 100 submissions, she may forward just maybe two or three, because already she knows the type of books we produce. So Stasis was a type of book that I wasn't quite understanding. I probably still don't quite understand, but it's not necessarily about that. It's about the idea. And of course, the idea is almost as important as the picture. So that's how it started. Katie then says, I've got this project. It's very interesting. I want you to have a look. And then we started to have a look at it. And it's taken ages. When did I first talk to you, Stacey?
I've been trying to remember that. I think it was around November or October 2018.
Right. So maybe, are you sure? Not even a bit earlier? It might have been a year earlier, because we met at Elliott's because I was working there. And of course, I was in New York and then I met Stacey. So every time I would come over, you and I would sit and put pictures and look at it on the floor, or I would go to your house and we'd do the same. The process that we do, I'm going to just tell everybody, is that we have printouts and we lay them down the floor in order to get a sequence. I think actually, in truth, we did it at your house first to get an initial tighter edit. I'm correct, aren't we, Stacey?
I can't remember actually if it was Elliot's studio first or my house first or both. Did you come to my house twice or only?
Yeah, and you came to Elliot's twice. So again, the process is it's never a quick process because we've got to work it out. So, you know, I don't know whether you want to talk about the project itself, Stacey, or whether you want to bash on a bit more about just the design process.
Well, why don't I give a little bit of background?
I
can share my screen and show the slideshow of images. Hello, everyone. I'm Stacy Mehrfar. Just thank you so much, Stu and Anne and everyone at Impressions Gallery. Ooh, hold on. That's not what I meant to do. Sorry. Sorry, one second. I am upstate New York, not in my house, not in my regular zone working. So if you just bear with me a second, please.
I'm in my regular working place, Stacey. I probably should have managed this because everything is exactly as it was. You know, I haven't gone on a holiday on the day we're supposed to do a talk. You know?
Try to make everything happen.
Okay. I tell you what, if you're ready, if you're not, I can just say, so the book is actually designed in sections, and it's to do with uncoated paper that is printed silver, and then color sections. So it's quite a complicated affair. And when you do this, it really dictates the flow of the book. And that can be a good thing, but it also can be a cross to bear. But anyway, Stacey, I'll now let you go now. You seem to have mastered the technology.
Thanks, Stu. The slideshow sequence that you have here is the exact sequence from the book. The project, The Moon Belongs to Everyone, started in 2014. I immigrated to Australia in 2008, and I found the emotional effects of moving home, of moving across borders, of moving across the world, really difficult. And it was kind of unexpected. I didn't plan or think that I would have such a difficult time. But after living in Australia for a few years, I realized that the landscape around me, because it was so different, had really affected my sense of place, my sense of belonging, and a feeling of loss really was overwhelming. And I started to photo.
Can I interrupt a sec? You said you found it really, really difficult. In what way?
Being in a new landscape was very strange. I don't know. You feel out of bounds. You feel as if you don't really belong where you are. You're no longer tied to the landscape that you are surrounded by. I guess I had very strong feelings of the landscape that I grew up in, which was similar to this, but not as beautiful. I grew up in Long Island, but in a very woodsy area. When I moved to Australia, all of a sudden the sunlight is so bright yellow. The trees are windy and curvy, and the dirt is so different. Everything, the ocean, everything is so different. And I felt lost. I felt a sense of imbalance, I guess I would say. And I started to photograph through those emotions. I started out the project in a very documentary way, photographing my everyday, going for drives throughout Sydney. And then these color fields that you see, that those were the first images that I made for the project. And they were the flowers. On these walks, I noticed how bright and beautiful the flowers in Australia were, and the colors were so different than the flowers around where I had grown up that I was mesmerized by them. And I started to take my camera lens and put it directly into the center of the flower petals and bulbs. There's a color field coming up now. And so I realized that I could start to talk about emotion and this sort of sensibilities that I was going through by creating images that were a little less documentary and a more emotive. And that's kind of how it started, and it progressed through there. And I photographed during the period that I lived in Australia. I was photographing between New York and Australia. I wanted to mix the different landscapes within the work so that together the project becomes sort of anywhere and nowhere at once. It's no longer tied to a specific location, which is how I felt. And I can talk about the people. All the people in the photographs were all made in Australia, and they're all immigrants like myself who had moved from one part of the world there. The people I photographed were refugees. It was at the time I was interested in how people choose to pick up and move home. And we all felt, while I was photographing them, we had deep conversations about what it meant to be part of a community, what home meant, what community meant, how landscape affected the way that they saw themselves, how it formed identity. And within that, we all kind of spoke about this similar sense of being in limbo. And it didn't matter where we came from, but we all sort of understood our way in the world in a very similar way. And I found that very interesting. I was going to say something else, but now my mind has slipped about the idea of moving home. So I moved back to New York, and I thought the project would be finished. I moved back to New York in 2016, and at the time it was a very obvious tumultuous time, and the term immigrant became very charged. I come from an immigrant family, and my parents came from New York, from Iran to New York in the late 60s. And so the idea of being an immigrant was always a sense of pride, came from a place of pride But then in 2016, all of a sudden, as we all know, worldwide, it became a very charged term. And so I became interested in that as well and continued to photograph while I was living in New York or when I moved back to New York. And so the images in the book are from 2014 to 2020. And the one from 2020 came in because of COVID, right? Stu, we were supposed to have gone to print in March, but because of COVID, we weren't able to. So yeah, I think I'll end it there. That's the slideshow. I can start it again if we want to look at more images, or maybe we can look at the book and talk a little bit more about the process of publishing the book.
Yeah, I think so, maybe. So as Stacy said, we were due to print probably in March, which was, or maybe in April, when just as the lockdown started. So that was nearly, what was that?
It was supposed to be March 1st, 2020. We were supposed to be on press in Italy.
We had it booked. You hadn't quite booked your flight. We were just about to start it, and of course this happened. So when did we actually print it? We printed it a year and a half later.
Yeah, a year later. So it was supposed to be, I was supposed to meet you in London on February 28th, 2020. We were supposed to fly to Italy March 1st, I believe.
Yeah.
We canceled the trip February 28th. And then you ended up taking the book to press without me in December 2020. So not a full year, but it was about a year and a half before it came out, because by the time it left Europe or was able to arrive in your warehouse in England and then come to me in the US, it wasn't until May 2021.
Yeah. And of course, what's interesting, we always encourage our photographers to come on press with us because we want them to see the nuances and what happens. And the problem with printing is that you photographers have a specific color they might want. And it's only when they're on press they can understand how that color might shift. And if they're not there looking at it, it might be that they get the copy back and they're going to complain. Because photographers are quite pernickety. All visual artists, I think, by their very nature, are quite difficult people. And their pictures, photography especially, is how they want it. It's a very specific thing. So I really wanted you to be on press so you could actually see it, but we just knew we couldn't. And if we delayed it longer, who knows what was going to happen. And we needed to get it out. We needed to move on. So the interesting part is we decided to print certain sections, the black and white sections, in silver on black paper, which was quite tricky. I had done it previously with something else and it worked out to be such a treat. And I know, Stace, you were really anxious that the people, the tonal values of the people was going to be quite bad, because it wasn't duotone, it's just a half tone. But we ended up with these fantastic, you may or may not see it, but these fantastic silvers. So it's silver ink on black, but it produced a fantastic quality and the detail was immense. And I think you're quite surprised. So was I actually, Stacey, to be honest. When I was there, I saw it come out. I thought, oh, that's working a treat. So that was those sections. And as I say, the sections interspersed then with the color sections, which work in color fields. So we that's how we designed and worked it out. Interspersed again with these black and white pages, which are in sections of eight. So everything had a number and had to work out as a sequence. And that took a long time for us to actually get right, because you get it nearly right and it's like a Rubik's Cube, and then that other bit doesn't quite fit, and then you realise you're a picture short, or this picture doesn't fit with this picture, or the colour field doesn't work. I think the black and white pages were easy, much easier, because we had a certain amount of pages and we knew what we were going to do with them. So in essence, that was the easy bit. The hard bit was trying to make the other pages work and fall into sections. So of course, that's how we work out all these things when doing our books, is how many pages we can get on the press. We also talked about the type of color of the thread. Often the thread is white and we've used black thread so that it, so there's a number of things that we've done and tweaked it. And the last thing was, we also, I know, Stace, you're very worried about the pictures going over the gutter. And of course I would say, no, we'll put it straight across the gutter. And the problem is, as you notice, the faces go right through their noses. And if the book doesn't open flat, it's going to be a bit of a bugger. So we do what's known as, I think it's called Swiss binding, where it's open binding. And because of that, it allows the book to open completely flat. So that's how we are enabled to get, as you go through, to open the book and it being flat. And if you look on the side, you can see the white pages and the black pages. So it's a sort of numbering sequence. You go through some color, then you get these portraits, then you go back again. So it goes back and forth, and this sort of flow and how it works. That sounds simple and sounds a little, you know, like we could have done it in a weekend. But like with most books, it takes a heck of a long time to work out and work out a sequence, a lot longer than I think anybody realizes. And I'm not saying it's just you, Stacey. It wasn't that you were useless and slow. It really is the process. And it takes a long, long time to know that you've got it right and you lay it out and you then start to look at it and this picture just may not quite work. And then we have to change it again. And it's a back and forth process. And normally I do it with the person and we might try and get it done on a weekend. But we now, or I now as well, have to do it remotely and we have to do it that way. So that probably was the difficulty, is the fact that it stopped and started, I think. Don't you think, Stacey? Mm.
Yeah, I think that though you were able to come to New York close, like two periods that were close in time. And I think that was helpful. I remember that we did two or three in person on the floor. And as we understood that, you know, as we did that, we started to understand how we were going to separate the sections, how the color fields were going to fall through, how many pages the black and white images were going to have in each section for each signature. And I think once we got that down, then it was a lot of back and forth, sending PDFs back and forth in terms of the sequence. But then from, you know, we had it done in March 2020, and because we had the extra time, we were able to swap one or two photos. I actually think it was only one photo in the end. But I wanted to comment on a few things that you said. One was about not being on press. Really worried me a lot. But I was privileged to work with Claudia, your production person, who's amazing. And she really took the time to sit with me and go over what I wanted each image, what kind of tonalities I wanted each image to have. Color is super important in the way that the sequence flows, so that, for instance, in this section, you'll see that the yellows carry over. And I wanted it to have a rhythm that came through the color. And Claudia really understood that. And so I have to say, compared, you know, this book, compared to other, my other book, I really feel there's no area where I was upset with the way that the color came out. Everything feels really bang on. And that is all due to Claudia's wonderful patience with me and taking the time. So you'll see that the yellow in this section carries through. And the other thing I wanted to make mention of is the silver. You mentioned, Stu, the silver on the portraits, and we were really concerned about how it was going to come out because we didn't really have a sense until you're on press. And one woman that I interviewed with, Brie Lamb, she said it reminded her of a daguerreotype, which I thought was really brilliant because the faces kind of come forward and recede at the same time if you see the way that it hits the light. I thought that was a really beautiful way of explaining it and also plays into this idea of not feeling settled or not feeling tied to the landscape.
And of course, the other thing, Stacey, just to interrupt on that, on the portraits and the silver on the black was, we never, although we kind of did it in a PDF, you never really got a full idea of how it might look or how the skin textures might be being in silver, because it's almost a negative, but it wasn't, it became a positive. But I was trying to explain that it'll work, but we didn't really know. So it was only on press, and I had my phone and we were doing FaceTime or whatever the other WhatsApps, you know, showing you as it came off on press, and Stacey was on the phone. I'm saying, look, this is it. This is what we've got. And really, can you approve it? But really, it's too late, Stacey. I knew it. But the point was, it came out a treat. And it was a bit. We were flying by the seat of our pants, which, as you know, Stacey, I love doing.
Yes, I know very well. Thanks, Stu. What else? The Swiss binding. Yes, to make sure that the images lay flat was really important.
Of course, with all these things like Swiss binding, you know, all these have technical issues. It lays flat, but because it's not bound so tight on the spine can loosen or the glue can be, you know, there's a lot of little technical issues. And I think you had a book which had less glue, which you preferred, and then I've got more glue, which you were not sure about. And of course, if you have less glue, it'll tend to pull apart. So in, you know, in time of looking at it, the sections will start to pull apart. So it's a double-edged sword and all these things. I mean, technically, doing the book and printing it is one thing, but getting a bound book and copy is another. Even delivery, at every point, it's a calamity waiting to happen, which we try and avoid, as you know, Stacey. I mean, you had done a book before, so it was all right, because a lot of people haven't. It is a baptismal fire, and it's quite a frightening thing to watch your pictures on press take on something else. And as you have been on before, at least you had a little understanding. But each time I go, and I printed many books, but each time I go on press, I'm always surprised, because something turns up that I didn't expect. And you'd think that I know everything that's going to expect, but something always, there's always a curveball. I think I told you that, Stacey. I didn't pretend that it's all going to be smooth. And it,
yes. So
I think the curveball here was the fact that I didn't know how the silver was going to be, whether it would come out so well. And the truth it came out a treat. As I say, I had done something else before, for Nicholas Hughes, where it came out really well. And I had an inkling, but his were much more monochromatic. They didn't have so much detail. Yours are far more detailed. But again, I think we helped the black and white, and we helped it within the book. I think had they been straight black and white or duotone on white pages, I don't think they would have had this power and this effect and this flow and this link, because those black pages link. And at the same time, that's why all the color pages bleed. So there's no white space, if you like. And that was a deliberate thing too. So everything flowed. So you almost don't notice that there's black pages and then they're not black pages. They're actually white, but with the four color printed on. But again, it was all an idea to try and create this flow.
Yeah, I was just gonna say, I wanted the book to be an experience in and of itself. And Stu really understood that I wanted it to be like when you watch a film and you become captured by the story that the film tells you, and there's no way out. That's how I wanted the book to progress. So you enter the book and it's as if you're watching a film, you're watching it progress past you, and there's no place for your eye to wander. So there's no white borders. There's no really separation from image to image. And as I said before, the color flow is really important in that. I wanted you to feel like you enter a universe. So this is the artwork in and of itself. You're entering the universe of The Moon Belongs to Everyone. And Stu really, even though he says he didn't understand the project, he understood it as a book and what I wanted the book to do and how I wanted it to function very well. So thank you, Stu.
And your title, The Moon Belongs to Everyone. Just your title, is that, just explain it to me again.
So what it means or where I got it from?
No, both.
Okay, so I'll start with where I got it from. So at the time of early days of making the work, my husband and I were watching Mad Men, the TV show. We were a few years late watching it. And one of the last episodes, there's a scene where one of the main characters comes back and he's dancing to the Sam Cooke song, The Best Things in Life Are Free. And there's a line in that song, "The Moon Belongs to Everyone." And it stuck with me. And in the middle of the night, I remember very vividly, I woke up and I went, "Oh, the moon belongs to everyone. That's the title." And I jotted it down on a piece of paper next to my bed. And that's kind of how it stuck. And now the idea is that it doesn't matter where we come from, what borders we're kind of entrenched by, we all have a relationship to the moon. We all have a relationship to these normal ideals, these normal everyday occurrences, the ocean, the moon, the sun, and regardless of where in the world we come from, we can understand those in a similar way. So again, going back to the idea of the immigrant experience being a universal experience, or the way that I wanted to express it.
I didn't realize that your parents came over from Iran.
Yes, in the late 60s.
You never told me that.
I'm sure I did.
No, Stacey. We sat down. We had cheese and hummus, but you never told me the sort of the family history. I mean, to close, because I think we're nearly at the point where Anne's going to jump in a sec, or at least start talking. You know, everything that we do within the book, you know, the thickness of the boards, As I explained, the thread, which is black instead of white, which it normally is because pages are white and you don't want black thread interfering. You know, all of it was considered, and it all of that takes a tremendous amount of energy and time. I mean, as we know what we're doing, because we've done many books before, but it is still a brand new thing, each book. Each book is a brand, and I treat each book as an artist book. I want to produce an artist book. I don't want to do a mass-produced book, and therefore the materiality is important, and the cost of these things can be quite expensive. But again, I just think it's better that we do that instead of cutting a corner or not using the right paper or not using, you know, a foil when I could just print it, to really try and create something which is an experience. And I think that's what these books, that's how I look at these books. Mm-hmm. And that's what how I treat and how I design them. I used to do a lot of designs for other publishers, and they always would take the book off me, and then it would be printed in China, and just little corners would be cut. They would not use real end papers. They would just not use cloth if that's what I was wanted. It just, and I understand, because every unit price is key to making, you know, but I don't look at that at all. So in terms of a businessman, I'm useless. And I see you're there.
Yeah. So thanks for that. My question was going to be, how did you get the title? So that was a really good...
Sorry.
Stuart, for my question. But I love the title. It is so poignant, and it is...
Thank you.
It's just steeped in so much meaning. So yeah, great, great title. What I also really enjoyed about that talk, and it was a privilege, you don't often get to see the relationship between the artist, photographer, and the designer, editor. So that was a fantastic, the way you both animated it. Stuart, I loved your line about photographers can be tricky, did you say?
Tricky fish. I tell you, Anne, they are...
tell me about it. I could talk to you about it for hours. I'll move on from that.
Hey.
Oh, it's been recorded, whoops. Does anyone here in the gallery, do you have a question to ask? Because if you do, right, if not, can you see what's online, Stuart?
Yeah, I've got one by Rolf, and he said, hi, Stacey, it took me a long time to find a link for the meeting. But I don't think that was a question, I just think it was a comment. But I thought I'd read it out, because I thought, well, at least you did find the leak, and thanks for letting us know that you did take a long time. So no, that was a useless, you know, it wasn't really of any help to anybody, really, apart from the fact for him that he found it, which I'm pleased about.
So when's the book been published? Because we're sending them here. When was it published? You said, because it was meant to be printed at the start of lockdown. So yeah. Again, I found that whole process, what you were describing about doing a creative process, remotely, because yeah, that's been fascinating for me as well, and the projects I was involved in, and I think that was good for people to hear that it could still be done, but it wasn't without its problems. Mm-hmm. So I really like the way you explained how you overcame those problems, and the way practicalities and the printing. It must have been quite nerve-wracking for you, Stacey, was it?
Not very, very nerve-wracking. But like I said, Claudia Palladini, who works with Stu, is just phenomenal, and she really listened to all the things that I wanted the book to do and how I wanted the color to function and the tonalities to function, and she got it. You know, I was really nervous, and then Stu mentioned that I was on WhatsApp and FaceTime throughout the whole printing, and the whole time going, that's not what it's supposed to look like. I don't know what's going on. You know, it's very hard to be able to tell from a phone. It's not even on my computer, right? On a small screen on the phone. So I didn't know what to expect, but it was great.
My phone is an iPhone 4S, so maybe the quality also isn't so good. So, of course, you see, I will say, Anne, that when we talk about the reproduction, it's one of the most important parts of a book, and it's what a lot of people don't spend time on, because it can cost, you know, a quarter of what the book costs to do, just getting this repro right. And repro, I mean reproduction, converting files from RGB to CMYK, knowing how that conversion will work on the type of paper you're printing. And really, you're only talking about a matte paper or an uncoated in truth, you know, with slight variations. But if you don't spend the time doing that and have somebody that really understands that, and Cloud has been doing it for 10 years, maybe she came to me after she'd been doing it for 7, and she's been with me for 7. So she absolutely understands the color, and she also comes on press. So And she's Italian, so she can speak to our Italian printers, of course, in the language, because I've been there for 20 years and have only learned scusi. So, you know, it's I'm no use in trying to communicate. I point to a black and I just feel like that's saying less. So in English still. So it really, it makes or breaks the book. And I think it's what a lot of people don't understand. And again, they would if they do their book and they don't do the repro properly, and then they look at it and it's flat or it's not vibrant or it doesn't do what they want it to do. And what Stacy was talking about was very important, is the color fill within the images. So whether a color was slightly greener, we might have made it a little more orangier or a little more redder so that it had a color filled flow. And that's what Stacy was talking about when Claudia understood exactly how the colors need to go within each section. And again, that's not something you can easily do. So having somebody understanding the repro is key to making a book work, especially yours, Stacy.
So that's a handy hint to all you
very handy
out there in person and online. If you're making your photo book, Stu talks a lot of sense. Listen to him. I mean, that's what I love about that book and the way you described it. We've passed it around the audience here. You know, it is a beautiful physical object, but it is seen, you know, the subject matter is important as well. So it works on both levels, I think.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I think also the book is, you said, when was it released? To be truthful, I can't remember, because we're having such troubles, Anne, with flipping Brexit and export and then getting stuff to the US. Forget Brexit. I don't know what's happening, but we're having, you know, a book we did last year took 3 months in transit, which should have taken. Yeah, so that yours was on there with Mark Powers. It took that flipping long. So it's a real pain because we can't do publicity and then people can't find the book because it's not in the shops. This is the type of book that people need to see. So it went slow, but we're now, I don't know whether we've got, I don't know, we've got 50 copies in the US and 50 in the UK. We're down to the point where we have to put a sold out sticker and only keep it for fairs that we go to, because the minute people pick it up, they buy it. And that's the thing. It's one of the books that when people look at it, they might go, I'm not sure. But when they see it, they change their mind. So, and of course, that's the whole beauty of looking at books in person.
Because we've got it on sale here out there at the Photo Book Fair. So people, as Stuart said, have a look at it and buy it. Are there any you're selling online through GOST Books?
Yes. Oh, no, we still are, but we're aware that it's going very quick. And, you know, this is what happens. I mean, you know, I expect it'll probably sell out by the end of the year because of the fact we're in Perifoto 2. And then, again, when people see it, they then buy it. And that's the difference. But books are an immersive thing anyway. And that's why I think they're artist books, because it's about the texture and the smell and the paper, all these elements. And you must somehow covet that. Whereas if you do a book that is mass produced, it somehow loses that sort of feeling, that connection. But it, you know, it's a process.
Mm-hmm. Any I'll questions? Be a Perifoto too.
Oh. I won't.
Are you going to be at Perifoto, Stacy?
Or just that's the plan. I haven't booked my ticket yet. No, I'm planning on coming and set up a book signing for the Saturday.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Stu, I was hoping we could have some banter in person.
The trouble is, you know how these things frighten me, and I, you know, more people in a room, I start to get anxious, especially in a room that's so flipping big. So I'm desperate not to go, but, you know, I realise I might have to, but it fills me with dread.
And did you have a question?
Yeah, are there any more questions before we begin to wind up? I see a bit of anticipation in the audience, but they're all being a bit shy.
Yes.
Somebody asked what camera she used.
To ask a question, you have to come and stand where I'm standing so that they can...
Oh, there's...
X marks the spot. I didn't see that before, in case that would really put people off. Just stand there.
You didn't say this before.
I know.
Yeah.
Given your hi Stacy, thanks for the book.
Hello.
Thanks for talking about your book. I'm curious to know, where do you feel you're from, given your heritage, given your immigration story? I'm just curious to know.
I appreciate that question a lot. Thank you. I'd have to say that before I moved to Australia, I felt very, I don't know if you guys can still hear me. We've switched to...
No, they're just, it's fine. I'm sure they can.
Okay. Before I went to Australia, it was very clear that I was Iranian, I was American. I felt very strong about my heritage and my identity. When I moved to Australia, I also, my husband is South African, Australian. And so all of a sudden, and I hardly spoke Farsi because I didn't know anybody, any Iranians in Australia. All of a sudden, I felt very lost, as I said previously. And now coming back to New York, I thought I would feel a sense of identity and a sense of place again. But I'd say that I am more attached to the moon than I am to any location or any particular nationality or identity. And I think that's a beautiful, beautiful part of, you know, what's happening in the world today in terms of social media and, I mean, pre-COVID, and being able to sort of see what happens in everyone's worlds, that we're no longer kind of separated, that we can think of ourselves as one sort of part of one larger community rather than an individual's identity or an individual ethnicity.
That seems a good point to end the talk. I'll just do this for you again. The moon belongs to everyone. This is truly global.
Yes, that's right.
Uniting the world through books, through GOST books. It's on sale at our front desk out in the Photo Book Fair. Good luck with it, Stacy. Good luck getting to Paris Photo. Thank you for a really insightful, animated, interesting talk. Thank you.
Thank you for inviting.
And again, thank you to Karen Jett for really working out the technology.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Take care, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.